Hello, and welcome to another edition of UDC Forum. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber, Assistant Professor of History at the University of the District of Columbia, and your host. This forum will explore the state of our prison system and discuss the challenges of reentry for families and communities, as well as other related issues of criminal justice from the perspective of two people who have been involved with these issues for a number of years. Dr. Margaret Moore is a faculty member in the Department of Criminal Justice, Sociology, and Social Work at the University of the District of Columbia. She is a national leader in the area of corrections. She formerly served as the Director of Corrections in the District of Columbia and Deputy Secretary of the Pennsylvania Department of Corrections. Her research interests include elderly inmates, violence against women, and intra-family violence. Rozier T. Roach Brown, while serving a life sentence, created and founded the nationally acclaimed prison theatrical troupe, The Inner Voices. During the 1970s, The Inner Voices performed outside the gates of Lorton Correctional Complex over 1,500 times without an escape or incident. The Inner Voices performed original plays, skits, and social dramas. Roach, as he likes to be called, has worked as a television, radio, and film producer, playwright, political activist, director of community programs, criminal justice consultant, and motivational speaker. He presently produces and hosts the Pacifica radio program Crossroads on WPFW 89.3 FM in Washington, D.C., which can be heard worldwide via the internet on www.wpfw.org. Roach writes a column for the Washington Informer newspaper on criminal justice issues. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The topic of prison reform is one that's causing quite a lot of controversy. There are individuals who are prison reform advocates. We certainly know families are concerned with reentry and the process by which loved ones and family members are coming home. The community is involved as a stakeholder in what's going to happen when these individuals come home. Social services are involved. What are some of the concerns that you see expressed from some of the stakeholders involved? Dr. Moore, let's start with you.
Well, let me begin, Dr. Jowers, simply by mentioning that in this country there are more than 2 million men and women locked up in this nation's prisons. 650,000 of those men and women on an annual basis return to our communities from prisons. Another 7 million are returning from jails. So the issue of prisoner reentry is one that should be a matter of concern for every citizen in the United States, but particularly for those of us who are African-American, Latinos, and live in communities where these prisoners come from for the most part and ultimately will return to. The issues are many. Needless to say, a lot of the men and women coming out of prison are in dire need of social service support, housing, employment, job training, health and mental health services, but particularly substance abuse, which is a significant problem in urban communities and certainly among the prisoner population. Somewhere around 80% of all men and women in prisons and jails have a history of substance abuse. And unless we can deal with that substance abuse as a means of interrupting, if you will, the criminality associated with it, our efforts at prisoner reentry will be far less than successful.
Bruce, let me ask you, as someone who went through the reentry process, what is your perspective on it?
I agree with what Dr. Moore said. There's all the issues that she elaborated on are pertinent, vital, and necessary, but there's another component. I've served over 30 years and 4 months. Half of my life has been spent inside a prison. We've run programs inside, self-help programs, reentry, et cetera. One of the main issues that's not been addressed, that need to be addressed, is the social, psychological, and technological advances that have happened while these men and women are, have been away. I've been confronted with one of the problems myself. When I came out after the last stint, I went to Union Station to use the restroom, and when I got up off the seat, it flushed. So I dropped to my knees and looked all under the stall and tried to find out who did that. It was nobody there. So I walked to the face bowl to wash my hands while looking over my shoulder, and the water came out of the face bowl. I didn't even touch a knob. And I was devastated. I didn't know what to do, who was cutting on the water, the face bowl. So a lot of men and women coming out, psychologically, you are not prepared. You can get a job. You can get a place to stay if you're lucky. Because most men coming out now cannot go home. Because of the policy and the discrimination against returning citizens, if your mother or loved ones live in public housing or low-income housing and their name is not on the lease, they cannot stay with their mother, even though they grew up in that particular house. Now, private realtors are making it difficult for people with criminal records to get a property. So the bottom line is, we need to focus on these men and women who are returning, because if you don't deal with it now on the front end, we're gonna deal with it on the back end. And you see these horrendous crimes that are, kids are killing babies. One guy executed his mother in New York and cut her head off and held the head up. You see these kind of crimes. Hurt people hurt people. These folks are hurting tremendously. And they don't know where to go. They don't see no hope. They're hopeless. They're faithless. They're jobless. They're homeless. They don't have any education. And you got all these lesses, and you see everybody with all the mores. Something got to give, and this means we are in jeopardy. Everybody is in jeopardy. As it was said before, it takes a community to raise a family, a kid. It takes a community to save our kids and make sure that these men and women get a fair shot.
Mm-hmm. What do you say to individuals in an economy where people who have had jobs for many years have lost them, in an economy where jobs are hard to find, when you're right about the not having the technology and the skill? Where is the funding coming from? Where do you see the compassion there, even for people to want to make a way for people who are reentering? Mm-hmm.
Dr. Jowers, the reality is this. We spend, as taxpayers, on average $60 billion a year on corrections alone. $60 billion a year on corrections. Many correctional systems now are beginning to realize that, number one, we can't build our way out of the crime problem in our society. Number two, our criminal justice policies that focus on incarceration cannot be sustained economically. So what systems are attempting to do now is what is known as justice reinvestment, whereby we recognize that our $60 billion expenditure is not providing the outcome that one would expect. You know, that is when individuals leave prison, that they successfully reintegrate back into our community and become contributing taxpayers. That's not what happens in reality, because in reality, about offenders who leave our system are returning. They're rearrested within 3 years of their release. So we're looking at justice reinvestment strategies as a means to address the high cost of corrections and as a means of addressing the human and social issues associated with the high rate of incarceration in African American communities. If we were to take a portion of the $60 billion a year that we spend on corrections and reinvest those dollars in, let's say, early childhood education, whereby we could prevent kids from coming into the system in the first place, if we would take a portion of that $60 billion, reinvest those dollars in housing, substance abuse treatment, health and mental health services for those men and women who are returning to our community in need of this type of support and service, I suspect that we will begin to see a more favorable outcome with respect to those men and women who are being released to our communities from prison.
Can I like to add something to what you just said about the folks returning and coming back and the numbers of the 2 million folk incarcerated? I just read that there's 3,300,000 kids were expelled last year nationally. And we had a march last week called the School to Prison Pipeline. And they are expelling students of color, minorities, for disciplinary and behavior issues and arresting them and placing them in handcuffs. So these kids are already in the pipeline. If we got two million plus already in prison, you got 3,300,000 waiting to come in who are growing up. Secondly, I see something very onerous about this whole situation in that once you get a record, somebody is considering up on Capitol Hill to pass some legislation to use juvenile records. Currently, if you commit an offense under 18, they cannot use that against you when you become a man or a woman. Now they're talking about allowing law enforcement to use your criminal history as a juvenile, which would further increase the number of folk who've been isolated and marginalized in our society. So we got folk with a criminal record. If you look at the day right now on the paper, everybody buying guns. It's a town in Georgia, the entire county bought a weapon. The only people can't get a weapon is somebody with a criminal record, mental illness, if you don't need one. So with all out, the majority of our population with criminal records, you can't get a weapon. They are preparing for what they assume is a race war that's coming down. These guns are taking off, and our folk, again, we can't defend ourselves, we can't support ourselves, we can't raise our families, we can't go to the store to buy any, we don't have any credit, we don't have anything, and we've just been, it's like going on a spaceship to head to the moon, and halfway between Earth and the moon, they kick all the minorities out, all the ex-offenders, all the people with criminal records, and we're floating around in space. We're floating around in the cities, we're floating around all over the country. Something has to be done, and it has to be done soon and quick, because I don't know nobody who can go weeks or months without nothing to eat, no place to sleep, and you got families and kids who don't even respect their parents because their parents can't even, the father can't bring the bacon home. He can't even bring home a ginger snap. You know what I mean? So that respect for the family, the whole family structure is being destroyed. The fastest growing prison population is black women. They locked up the men, now they're getting the kids, now they're getting the mothers and our grandmothers. It's not just about criminality. It's a lot deeper issue. I call it racism. It's dealing with Dr. Michelle Alexander. She's not a doctor, but what she did in her book,
The New Jim Crow.
This is the exact same things that's going on. People being locked up and given impossible. I talked to a lady the other day, got 13 life sentences and didn't kill nobody. 13 life sentences, 40 years old with 5 kids. And she got 13 life sentences because she was involved in a drug conspiracy. And everybody told on her. So I'm glad you're doing this, Dr. Jowers, and we need to do this on a regular basis because Jesus came out of prison. He took him out of cell and executed him. They called it crucified. Now they're doing what's called prison-fied. We're being prison-fied. They crucified Jesus, but they're prison-fying us.
One of the other issues that I wanted to talk about was when you talked about capital individuals sitting on Capitol Hill making laws. Councilman Barry tried to get a piece of legislation passed that allowed ex-offenders to provide an easier platform or entryway into employment situations.
Human Rights Amendment,
and he was not successful in that. Where do you see the legislative push coming from to make it easier? I mean, Councilman Barry, of course, is so popular with his client, with his constituents, but was unable to get it through the council. So what do you see happening with the legislation?
Legislation has been floating around since 1979 when Marion Barry first became mayor. Jim Baldwin was the director of Office of Human Rights, and we submitted the bill then to treat everybody with add an amendment to the Human Rights Bill. Besides, then you can't discriminate because of race, creed, color, sex. We wanted to add because of a criminal record or criminal conviction. Some members of the council did not support that legislation, and it died. And we've been trying for a while. Ironically, the president of the United States, Barack Obama, 3 weeks ago supported the gays being involved with the Boy Scouts. And he quote in the statement he gave, it was a quote. that gays should be treated as human beings and have afforded all opportunities as all citizens and not be discriminated against. That's beautiful, Mr. President. But what about returning citizens? We are discriminated against blatantly, openly, without no shame, no nothing. And then they ask, like Ms. Dr. Moore said, we got a high recidivism rate. How long can you live without nothing to eat, a place to stay, or some place to live? You have to do something, and folks are begging. I see people every day committing suicide, eating out trash cans, robbing the bank and standing right in front of the bank to get arrested because they know they got three cots and a place to, and something to eat. This is a crisis in our community. It's a crisis for America. You know what I mean? If you don't deal with it now, you're going to deal with it on the back end.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Moore, I'm sorry, go right ahead.
No, I was just about to say that the reality is it's not a question of whether men and women are going to return to our communities from prison. It's only a matter of when
and how
and in what condition. You know, when and to what extent are they able to negotiate the systems to successfully reintegrate back into our communities. From a legislative standpoint, from a moral standpoint, from an ethical standpoint, it just makes sense that we support legislation that that does not discriminate, you know, that makes it unlawful, if you will, to discriminate against individuals who have been convicted, who have served their time, and who are now trying to come back into the community living normal lives. Okay, this is a problem for not just for Marion Barry and the citizens of Ward 8. It's an issue that should be a matter of concern for every citizen in the District of Columbia in every ward, because we're all affected.
And why do you think it isn't? Because you don't hear that kind of, you hear the conversation for the two of you involved in it, but you don't hear that sort of uproar from the community.
The groundswell.
Right.
You know, it's, I've been asking myself that same question. I grew up in Washington, D.C., and it was very race segregated. We couldn't come where we're located now, Connecticut Avenue. I couldn't come up here after 8 o'clock at night, where this campus is located, unless you had on a worker's uniform or a chauffeur's uniform. And that same discrimination with that paternalistic attitude, and they look at us like black people born with a gun or you're born with a mask, and why we got such a high crime rate. It's the haves and the have-nots. And when you see kids with no hope, 16, 17 years old, and he get a little girlfriend, he can't take his girl to McDonald's because it costs $25 now to go to McDonald's with a boy and his girlfriend. There's no place these kids can go. They can't make no money. If you notice, the open-air drug markets have been eliminated. People don't even have money to buy drugs. Not the way they used to have it. The economy is such that we're being squeezed out. They used to call D.C. Chocolate City. It's Chocolate Ripple or Chocolate Chip.
Where does the issue of class come in? Because there are African-Americans who are not running to this issue. There are African-American children who have places to go, who are going to school, who are not caught up in this. So there's something else other than just the racial piece.
Well, I think race and class are both factors when we look at the criminal justice system. We know that African-Americans and poor folks are more likely to be arrested, prosecuted, and incarcerated. We know that. I mean, the evidence is there. The statistics support this. So it is a matter of race and class. But again, the reality is this is not a problem for black folks or brown folks or poor folks. Incarceration and the factors that drive crime and incarceration is a problem that impacts all of us. Every taxpayer in the District of Columbia, every taxpayer in this nation contributes to the $60 billion a year mm-hmm. that we're spending on the correction system. So it's a problem for all citizens, regardless of race and class.
You know, it's socioeconomic. When you got two-thirds of your community unemployed, not working, their community is dying. There's no money in circulation. Black businesses are drying up. In 1968, there was like 2,500 black businesses in Washington, D.C. Right now, there's less than 35. No businesses. So the dollars that we had in our community would be circulated. If I bought something at your store, then you would spend it in another black business. So that dollar got 3-4 hits before it left our community. Now, we spend a dollar, it goes straight to Maryland or Virginia or someplace else. So the money is being dried up in the community. And you got a lot of folk who don't have an opportunity. They don't see no way out. You and I and Dr. Moore, we saw something. We know our history. I asked a guy the other day who was John Wayne, who was Malcolm X. One kid, 16, didn't know who Malcolm X was. Didn't know nothing about the voting rights or the Emancipation Proclamation. None of these things that we grew up with that gave us our history that we can, didn't know nothing about the voting rights bill. So you ask people, why is it we had a march last Friday, a Good Friday, Silent Day march, Metropolitan ME Church took the leadership and marched from the church down to Freedom Plaza. And we had a huge march, about 400 or 500 people. And it was about stop the prison pipeline and end gun violence. And folk were there talking, and you said, what, some folks have made it, why isn't it? There's a thing that says, injustice anywhere is injustice everywhere. And if they do it to me, they can do it to you. But because you've made it out and you appear, you forget that you are still one of us and you can get it. I've had cases of FBI agents being arrested on a BW Parkway calling to my radio program, and they're black. And when they told them that they were FBI, they said, we don't care nothing about you, you still are in. And they threw them on the ground and then arrested them. So even when you think you escaped, whatever, it's a certain amount of perpetual racism or discrimination that still exists. And particularly in New York City, just passed got a new policy to investigate all of these stop and frisks. Over 5,500 black and Latino were stopped and violently assaulted or frisked, thrown down on the ground, or what, and et cetera. Why is it that in all these cities we have a high rate of stop and frisk, driving while black, being arrested and stopped? You don't go to Georgetown and see 3-4 white kids thrown on the ground. Like it's in D.C. You can ride right down the street. Everywhere you go in Washington, D.C., you see cops grabbing young black males, throwing them on the ground. And I asked the chief judge, why is it I don't see no white kids being thrown on the ground? Well, they have other resources. That ain't the issue. The law, everybody's supposed to be treated equally under the law. Why is it our kids are targeted? Why are we targeted?
Yeah. Well, I wanted to just quickly ask you about some of the opportunities to perhaps be proactive. Dr. Moore had talked about opportunities, and one was the Inner Voices that you created. Tell us a little bit about how that worked.
Well, Inner Voices is an inmate self-help group, and we started that in Lawton, and it was, sure, we put on drama, but what wasn't revealed, we had intense group therapy sessions inside 3 nights a week amongst ourselves without no staff, and we put the chairs in a circle, and everybody had to lay themselves out bare on the floor, which is where the name Inner Voices came from. If you got in touch with your inner voice, and it's never ever wrong, where you can communicate and find your inner voice, Inner Voices drama group came out of those experiences. We got another group we started called DTRM, Doing Time with the Right Mind, that's in 16 federal prisons right now. It's an inmate self-help group, how to do time with the right mind. Dr. Moore and I was talking earlier about how some people go to prison and they discover their talent. Look at all the people who've been to prison who've made a mark on society. Fidel Castro, head of Cuba. Anwar Sadat, the president of Egypt. Nelson Mandela, from prison to the presidency. Sometimes the worst thing that happened to you is a blessing in disguise. If you can turn that around and get in touch with your inner voice, and you can do something. A lot of times men and women go to prison and they find themselves. You won't find yourself in the street because there's too many distractions. But when you're forced to focus on just you and what you have or what you don't have, if you got anything inside of you, it's gonna come out.
One of the things that we really want to focus on too is how individuals can make an impact. Do we write the city council? Do we right to present. What are some of the things that you would suggest for communities to push for this equality for reentering veterans and opportunities for them?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think as a community, we must come to the realization again that the reentry issue is not just an issue for the family across the street. You know, oftentimes we take the position that it's not my problem. If your son, your daughter, your brother, your sister, your husband, or your wife is not the one that has been directly affected, arrested, prosecuted, incarcerated, then we view it as not our issue. But the reality is that it is our issue. It is a community issue. And when Marion Barry introduces legislation, as a community, as individual citizens, we need to be at the city council supporting him in the introduction of that legislation, not just the introduction of it, but ultimately the passage of that legislation. We as citizens, individuals, and collectively, should be initiating action, should be giving voice to this issue. One of the things that is quite disturbing to me, Dr. Jowers, is that we have a tendency to be issue-focused individuals. And what I mean by that is when there is an issue, a single issue, we will show up in mass at the council. But once that issue is no longer in the forefront, you know, we forget about the fact that one in three African-American men in this country, and indeed right here in the District of Columbia, is under some degree of criminal justice supervision, if not locked up in prison or jail. These need to be issues that we're giving voice to on a regular, daily basis, not just when my son gets locked up or my daughter gets locked up.
We will have to come back for another time and talk more about this and have our inner voices heard. Thank you very much.
And Merry Christmas.
Thank you. If you would like more information about the academic programs and events by the University of the District of Columbia, visit the university's website, www.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber.